Institute for Historical Studies on this unusual Wednesday. We have as our guest speaker the author of a book that we will be talking about in one moment, Lauren Gutterman, who's an assistant professor of American Studies here at the University of Texas at Austin. She's also a core faculty member in women's and gender studies. And she is a faculty affiliate of the History Department and LGBTQ studies. She's the author of the book she'll be discussing is her book, Her Neighbor's Wife, A History of Lesbian Desire Within Marriage, which was the winner of the 2019 Berkshire Conference of Women Historians Book Prize. She has published articles on the history of gender, sexuality, popular culture, digital history, and oral history in the Journal of Social History, Gender and History, The Public Historian, the Journal of the History of Sexuality, and the Oral History Review. She also co-hosts a podcast called Sexing History. So I'd like to first just give you a sense of how this will proceed. Lauren will speak and introduce us to her book. After that, we will have questions monitored by our graduate research assistant, Brittany Irwin. If you have questions during the presentation itself, or if you have questions that you already want to ask on the basis of what you've read, you can use the Q&A function to let us know what they are, and it's helpful for us, in, for Brittany in particular, in sorting the questions. I want to thank Courtney Mador, as always, for her indispensable help with making this this event happen. I think we can start, Lauren. I think we can just start with your presentation now.
Excellent. Thank you so much, Marian. Let me try and share my screen. Is that showing up for folks? Great.
Yes.
Well, first of all, thank you all so much for being here today when nothing else at all is going on in the country or the world. So I appreciate that. Thank you for Marian for inviting me to present, and thank you so much to Courtney, who has worked so hard to plan this event, which was originally scheduled for last spring, and then COVID happened, and you know she has made this event happen despite the pandemic and this landmark presidential election. So I really appreciate that. I think I haven't timed it, but I think I'll talk for about 20 minutes. Don't want to overload people about kind of the overarching arguments of the book, how it came to the project. And then I thought I'd share some kind of juicy stories and cultural materials to give us some light distraction today before opening up for discussion, which I'm really excited to get into. I'd like to begin with the present. Even in the last few months, we have seen a plethora of wives who desire women in the public eye. So, and I apologize for my dog barking in the background. So up here is Molly Weisenberg, the food writer who had the blog Orangette for a long time. She just published a memoir in the last few months about how she fell in love with another woman while she was married to her husband. Her husband agreed to open their marriage for her to explore these feelings, and their marriage eventually ended, and now she's married to her non-binary partner, Ash. Of course, we have former Congresswoman Katie Hill, whose throuple with a female staffer, as well as her husband, became public knowledge after her estranged husband released naked photos of them together. Comedian Niecy Nash divorced her summer, her husband this spring, and then married her wife, Jessica Betts, just a few months later this summer. Michelle Smith, the fashion designer, was featured in the New York Times last week about her kind of changing styles and fashion, as well as her leaving her marriage and her husband and her relationship now with the fitness guru, Stacey Griffith. And then this just came up in my Twitter feed recently about, which was confirmed by one of these women, about two mommy bloggers who were formerly married to men and now are dating. So, you know, the list, of course, goes on and on and on. There are many other stories that I could have highlighted here. And news coverage of these women repeatedly presents their stories as new, as novel, as groundbreaking. Maureen Dowd, the New York Times columnist, described Katie Hill's story as very millennial. They often cite psychologist Lisa Diamond's controversial study, Sexual Fluidity. And, you know, in the news coverage of these women tends to use kind of new agey self-help language of journeys, coming into oneself. These women all make sense of their sexuality in different ways. Katie Hill identifies as bisexual. Some of them eschew kind of identity labels altogether. And Niecy Nash denied that her marriage was a coming out. She said, quote, "I don't feel like my marriage is coming out of anywhere, but rather going into myself and being honest about who I love." So while this kind of casting off of sexual identity labels and the language of sexual fluidity, of flexibility, journeys into self-knowledge is relatively new, my book shows that these women's lives are in fact part of a much longer history of wives who desire women, which I trace from 1945 to the present. All right. Oop. So I make several big arguments in this book. You know, one of them is that married women were able to engage in lesbian relationships to a much greater degree than we might expect historically, and especially in the immediate post-war period in the 1950s and early 1960s. And they did so, for the most part, not by visiting gay and lesbian bars or community spaces, although these explicitly gay spaces became more important over time in terms of providing a venue in which they could meet same-sex lovers. But instead, these women tended to engage in sexual relationships with women they met in the course of their daily lives, often very close to home, typically other women who had children of the same ages, who, you know, lived nearby or worked together with them, or, you know, their kids went to the same school or they went to the same church. I also show how balancing marriage and lesbian relationships, contrary to what we might expect, became harder for these women over time. In the post-war era, most husbands chose to turn a blind eye to their wives' relationships with other women, either because they didn't take them very seriously or because they didn't want to risk the stigma of divorce. At the same time, gay and lesbian activists in the homophile movement, in particular, knew how hard it was for women to live outside of marriage, you know, in explicitly or, you know, if not lesbian relationships, same-sex relationships, or even just as single mothers. Especially when they had children. And so these activists were relatively accepting of wives who desired other women. But in the 1970s, this really began to change as gay liberationists and lesbian feminists began to demand that people come out publicly to their family and friends and choose between marriage and lesbian life. So many of these women were confronted with a choice that they hadn't necessarily had to make before between a kind of lesbian community or relationships and marriage to their husbands. At the same time in the 1970s, the divorce revolution and the advent of humanistic psychology made these wives and their husbands more likely to talk openly about their unhappiness and their sexual desires and to choose to divorce. But as I show, wives who desired women increasingly came out of marriage and into lesbian identity in the 1970s. But as they did so, they experienced greater state discrimination, particularly in child custody battles with their exes. So rather than a kind of state discrimination lessening over time, it actually became more intense over the time period that I trace. Ultimately then, you know, by drawing attention to this space for same-sex desire within marriage, the book suggests a kind of queerness of marriage, particularly in the immediate post-war period. All right. So I'd be happy to talk more about the details of my argument. Some of you may have encountered them already if you had time to read the introduction. And I'd be happy to talk about the book as a whole, but I thought I would share with you today a little bit about the process of writing and researching this project, especially because there might be some grad students with us today. So this book began, as many academic books do, in a seminar, graduate seminar course while I was in school at NYU. And at the time, I wasn't really sure about my dissertation project. I knew I wanted to do something that centered queer women. And I realized by that point that if I looked in many of the conventional places that historians have looked to trace queer history in gay organizations or community spaces, arrest records, bars, those types of things, that women's lives and women's stories would be very much outnumbered by men's. So as I kind of searched around for a dissertation project, I started reading some lesbian pulp novels and post-war psychiatric studies of lesbianism, as well as the newsletters of the Daughters of Bilitis, the nation's first lesbian rights group. And in these materials, the figure of, you know, what they called the lesbian wife or the married lesbian really stood out to me. And on this page are just a kind of few of my, some of my favorite pop culture examples. You know, there's countless mass marketed pulp novels featuring this figure of the lesbian wife in the 1950s and 60s. This book here, Death of Anger, focuses on a woman, Hedwig, who's a lazy, domineering wife, and she remains in bed for 12 years in protest after her husband rapes her. This is, of course, Patricia Highsmith's 1955, The Price of Salt, which was recently made into the movie Carol. This is a 1963 cartoon from Playboy magazine that I came across in the files of the Daughters of Bilitis, because one member had kind of sent it to another. You know, she enjoyed the joke. Up here is the Kirk Douglas vehicle, Young Man with a Horn from 1950, in which Lauren Bacall here, her unnamed sickness ruins her marriage to Kirk Douglas and destroys his career as a jazz trumpeter. You know, they code her very carefully as lesbian, most explicitly in this brief scene here. And then also Walk on the Wild Side from 1962. In which Barbara Stanwyck is the married madam of a New Orleans brothel who is sexually obsessed with the French actress Capucine. So it was really, you know, this was where the dissertation began, where the book began, in my love of these kind of fun cultural materials. So then I really wanted to find out if there was any truth behind this figure of the post-war lesbian wife. But I really didn't think that I would be able to write a broad-scale social history of this population. And so my original plan for the project was to focus on just a handful of well-known writers and activists who had been married and engaged in lesbian relationships. Valerie Taylor, who was a pulp novelist, an activist, Lorraine Hansberry, the playwright and civil rights activist, and Del Martin, one of the longtime leaders of the Daughters of Bilitis. Very quickly, that plan fell apart because I couldn't access these women's papers for various reasons. It turned out that Valerie Taylor, even though her papers are at Cornell, she had burned all of her personal materials. Lorraine Hansberry's papers, anything pertaining to her lesbian relationships, are, you know, very famously restricted at the Schomburg. And Del Martin's personal papers just hadn't been, you know, sifted through by her longtime partner, Phyllis Lyon, and brought to the GLBT Historical Society, where they had the rest of their materials. So this plan fell apart, but in the process of beginning to do this research, I traveled to archives across the country, where I began to gather oral history interviews of these women who had been married, or women who had been the lovers of married women. And in 2009, I went to the GLBT Historical Society in San Francisco, where I discovered hundreds of letters that married women had written to the Daughters of Bilitis between the 1950s and the 1970s. And so in the process of reading through those letters and collecting oral histories, it became possible to imagine this project in a much broader scope. So here are just, I don't of course have as many images as I want, but these are just a few of the women that I talk about in the book. This is Blue London, butch lesbian, very young butch lesbian in New Orleans, who briefly lived with her married lover and her husband, and then ended up marrying herself after she became pregnant. This is Della Safransky in the 1950s, who I spoke with her son, her gay son, and she had a long time relationship with her next door neighbor, widowed mother, and they had attended, she's actually in costume here as a groom, which she and her lover went to a Halloween party in costume as bride and groom in Pennsylvania. This is Jeannie Morton in 1969 in St. Louis. She never actually divorced her husband, but they did eventually live separately. Early on in their marriage, he used to drop her off at the gay bars, but she claimed they never talked about what was happening. And then here's two formerly married women, Doreen Brann and Edie Daly, who fell in love in upstate New York in the 1970s. Doreen was a teacher, elementary school teacher, and Edie's children were in her class, and then she became a kind of teacher's assistant. Eventually they left their marriages. So it was discovering these stories of individual women that just really provided the foundation for the book, and the emotional center of the project, and that really helped to drive my work and my commitment to it. And the letters that I found at the Daughters, letters to the Daughters of Bilitis, were a particularly important source for me, as they documented the experiences of wives who desired women in the moment, of course. And certainly there were sad letters, as we might expect, but more often I was struck by how many married women demonstrated a kind of audacity, a sense of entitlement, and a real lack of repentance in pursuing lesbian lovers or connection with a broader lesbian community. Like, for example, one wife and mother from Jacksonville, Florida, who wrote to the editor of the Daughters of Bilitis's magazine, explaining that she had to burn her copy of the magazine each month so that her family wouldn't find it. Rather than canceling her subscription, though, she tried to get a cheaper rate by offering to return her copy of the magazine each month after she had read it. So in the end, I had far, far too many examples and details about these women's lives than there was room for in the book, and I had to cut a lot of examples out. And so I thought I'd share a few kind of excerpts of those letters with you today. So this one was written in 1958 by a married woman in Portland, Oregon, who was writing to Del Martin. Quote, "I am writing this to you as my friend, for I really feel as if you and I are going to be real friends. Something about the tone of your letter tells me you're a butch, and so am I. As I hinted but didn't really tell you, after all these years, I have really found myself thanks to a very dear girl I met in San Francisco. Unfortunately, she cannot come to Portland, so since I have returned here, I've been very lonely and have frequented the type of bars I am not accustomed to. I should actually tell you something about myself. I'm short in stature, being 5'2", tall, and weigh 117 pounds, no fat, broad-shouldered, brown eyes, and dark red hair. I'm in my early 40s, but do not feel or act my age. I have a fair education, a car, a Cadillac of my own, and I'm used to the better things in life. I'm free to come and go as I wish, although my husband is a norm." All right, and here is one more from a woman in McKeesport, Pennsylvania in 1965. Both this married woman and her estranged married lover wrote to the Daughters of Bilitis to complain about the other. Her letter begins by recounting every relationship or encounter she's ever had with another woman since she was 18. And then she writes, quote, "That was almost all up until 3.5 years ago when I made the worst mistake of my life. I tried, because I was in desperate need of someone, to change an old friend into a lover. The minute after I told her I wanted to make love to her, I knew I had made the greatest mistake of my life. I felt it because of what I saw in her expression and the fascination the subject held for her. I was the most interesting thing that had happened to her that year. She had found a new way to stake boredom. So like a kitten with a new ball of yarn, she's tossed me about until she got tangled in the yarn herself. She has learned much. It's no joke now. She would give her life for a few hours alone with me if I would make love to her and satisfy her very deep hunger for love. I would give her a reason to live. She claims she cannot live unless I am somewhere in her life. I permit her to call me on the phone only because we were old friends. She has hurt me deeply, has hurt me too deeply for me even to like her. I wish she would let me alone completely. I'm tired of the constant battle and struggle with her. This is supposed to be fun, not a fight to the finish. It would be nice to hear from you, but I beg you to be careful of what you say. My husband knows what I am, but there's no need to add fuel to the fire." All right, and I have one last letter that I'll read that's from 1972, and that suggests some of the ways these women's lives were changing in the early 1970s. The gay and lesbian movement was becoming more militant. Lesbian feminists were creating a broader and more visible lesbian community than had ever existed before. Divorce rates were increasing, and divorce was becoming easier legally and also less stigmatizing, which made it increasingly possible for women to choose to leave their marriages. But there were also factors that compelled women to leave their marriages too. Lesbian feminists in particular were very brutal to women who had relationships with both men and women, and especially to those who engaged in same-sex relationships while being married to men. And so here are just a couple examples. This is the radical lesbians marching in the Christopher Street Liberation Day Parade. Two really important lesbian feminist texts. Sappho was a Right-On Woman, and also Del Martin and Phyllis Lyon's Lesbian/Woman, both of which came out in the 1970s and reflected a harsher attitude toward women who were married to men but engaged in lesbian relationships. And then, of course, here's a very famous photograph of Mary Jo Reischer, a lesbian mother who lost custody of her young son in 1975 in Dallas before in a jury case. So this final letter I'll read is from a young bisexual identified woman in Iowa who had left her husband and was in the midst of a custody battle over her young son. Quote, coming out is an important chapter in one's life. It can become either a self-awareness or a self-denial. For me, it was a proudness and a sense of respect for myself that I had never felt before. Me, I'd always been open about my opinions and my personal life. So when I got married, my maid of honor was my lady, and I had confronted my husband about my sex life and settled in my mind for a life of bisexuality. When I broke up with my maid of honor and began other involvements with other women, my husband began to harass me constantly. And as for me, I began to realize I couldn't stand for male dominance in my life. She goes on to explain how the breaking point in her marriage came when she slept with another woman in a trailer in the back of her yard. Quote, at daybreak, Jean awoke and wanted to go. Shy, unsure of herself, and half hungover from the night before, there she was when my husband burst into the trailer and found us in bed together. This shook Jean so bad, she left immediately. As for me, it angered me so that my right to privacy had been so rudely violated. So, as Grayson Hunt, whom some of you might know from LGBTQ studies, said about this book, it is like the original L word. And so if you would like more lesbian drama, you can definitely find more of it in the pages of the book. But I would like to end my prepared remarks there and just really open it up to discussion and see what kinds of questions you all have. Thank you. Let's see, I think I can stop sharing.
All right, so I think we have, let's see, we have the Q&A open for anybody who has not submitted a question yet, and I'll just pull up to see what we've got here, and we can get started with that. Sorry for the delay. Here we go. Okay, first question from Tara Saunders, who says, so interested to hear you describe the, quote, audacity of these wives and the enthusiasm with which they engaged in communication with the daughters of the, I'm so sorry, how is this?
Elitist,
yes, thank you. Do you have any insight into how these women managed to escape what Adrian Rich called, quote, compulsory heterosexuality? I.e. any info about how they identified cultural models for their relationships and encountered ways to conceptualize and express their attractions, or any variation in class, race, et cetera.
Wow. Okay, thank you so much. That's a lot of questions. So let me think here. So first of all, I don't think they escaped the kind of compulsory heterosexuality, right? They got married to men, and that was, you know, very much, at least at the surface and public level, the way they organize their lives and their identities, you know, primarily as wives and mothers. Something I talk about in the book is the changing, shifting conceptions of, you know, sexual identity labels. And something that I noticed, you know, pretty clearly was that in the immediate post-war period, a lot of women following psychoanalytic experts used a language of like partial or incremental lesbianism. So they talked about having lesbian tendencies or lesbian inclinations. They really didn't use the word bisexual in the 1950s and early 60s, which was really discounted by, you know, psychologists and psychiatrists in that period. But they had this idea of a kind of a partial lesbian identity, and that was really the language that most of them used. I'm trying to think of the other parts of your question. I mean, in terms of where they learned about queer representations, you know, sometimes it was through lesbian pulp novels, you know, the classic Well of Loneliness. Some women kind of looked up the word lesbian in the dictionary. Of course, a lot of people learned the kind of stigma of the word queer from other kids or friends, you know, growing up. In terms of race and class differences, I mean, in some cases with the letters, it's hard because people don't always identify their race and class status isn't always clear. But certainly working class women were more likely to go to gay bars. Women of color, particularly Black women, had also a broader network of kind of community house parties that Rochella Thorpe talks about. She talks about Detroit specifically, that they had developed in response to the, you know, racial segregation of many gay bars in the post-war period. But something that I really found was that among women of many different races and class statuses, this tendency for these married women to fall in love and have relationships with women they met in the course of their daily lives was something that remained consistent. So, you know, there was a fairly wealthy woman who lived on Park Avenue in New York City in the post-war period, and she found tried to proposition another woman that, you know, was again a mother and a friend. And, you know, that was also true of a Puerto Rican young woman who had an affair with her mom's best friend living in the public housing projects, you know, in New York City as well. So really across kind of racial and class differences, these married women tended to find lovers in their close kind of immediate networks. Thank you.
Oh, thank you. I will say quickly for the listeners, if you would like to ask your question on camera yourself, we'll try to facilitate going back and forth. I saw we had a hand raised by Thomas Hubbard. So we'll try to get Thomas up on the screen here. Let's see. Here we go.
Hello, Lauren.
Hi.
I'm really fascinated by your work here. In fact, I was busily typing away my question, but our moderator got to me before I finished. most of the women in your sample appear to be women who wrote in to the Daughters of Bilitis. Many of them women who were already very consciously self-identifying as lesbian in virtue of going to lesbian bars and so forth. I'm really curious about the broader sample of married women who were either experimenting with, close physical relationships with their female friends, and nevertheless never left their marriages because they valued continuing to maintain a stable environment for their children. Mm-hmm. And to me, these are really some of the most interesting people to be asking questions about are the ones who did not recognize themselves as lesbians, much less as bisexual, which was hardly even a thing
mm-hmm.
in the 1950s. So what I'm wondering is, have you thought about looking into some of the quantitative data from Kinsey's surveys,
mm-hmm.
which were from exactly this period, in mm-hmm. terms of how many women who had had lesbian experiences were married and either left their marriages or stayed in their marriages? I really think the quantitative data is important, because my suspicion is there may be just as many of those women as there are of the ones that you're studying.
Well, thank you so much for that question, Thomas. So yes, I mean, in these letters like that I read, and the women who were writing into the Daughters of Bilitis, had some kind of familiarity either with like lesbian culture or homophile publications or, you know, a kind of queer consciousness. But a lot of the women, you know, that I talk about didn't. Those women though, I tended to find out about them through oral history interviews, either with those women themselves after they eventually left marriages or with their lovers. So there were certainly a lot of women that I talk about in the book who I don't have any identity, any clue about how they kind of sexually identified, and many women who remained married in various types of marriages, some that were kind of sexually open and some that were, it appears that their same-sex relationships remained a secret from their husbands. In terms of statistics, oh, I'm sorry, then the last thing I wanted to say about that was like that some women, you know, who eventually came into a kind of lesbian or bisexual identity talked very openly about how, you know, they would engage in same-sex relationships, but totally disavow the label. So, which, you know, maybe doesn't sound that surprising, but there was one really sad story that I included in there of there was a married woman, and she was involved with some religious organization and with another married woman, and they were making plans to leave their marriages one day. But it was not until she said the word lesbian, something like, I can't believe other lesbians are just like, or lesbians are just women like us. And the partner ended the relationship because it was just to be confronted with that label was too distressing. In terms of statistics, I do cite the Kinsey studies in chapter 4 in this period. I can't remember the statistic exactly. I mean, I think it was something like he found like not more than 1% of married women had engaged in, you know, same-sex relationships to, you know, the point of orgasm or whatever. Interestingly, a lot of psychoanalysts in this period, like Edmund Bergler, who was a big critic of Kinsey's work, believed that Kinsey was underestimating this population of kind of hidden lesbian wives because he was just taking women at their word. Bergler believed that Kinsey was undercounting this population of women. So the statistics are hard, but probably the stories that I've gathered are only the tip of the iceberg for sure.
Great, thank you. And thank you, Thomas, for coming on screen with us for a moment. All right, next question came in from Julie Hardwick, who said this was just what she needed this afternoon, which is probably a common thought there. She thanks you for your presentation and says, your timeline is very interesting about pressure to come out in the 70s, making coexistence, as we say about community responses to various fraught issues in early modern, more difficult and discrimination more likely. It complicates our histories of sexuality in such interesting ways. Since I, Julie Hardwick, is an early modernist, I wonder if you could look backwards as well as forward, not necessarily to her period of the 17th century, but in the decades before World War I, was this coexistence tied to particular phases of heterosexual marriage and household structures or something else?
Yeah, I don't know about phases of marriage, but I do know, of course, that like my timeline is artificial, which is something I acknowledge, and that I know that the history stretches back earlier, right? We could think easily about people like Eleanor Roosevelt, who had, lesbian relationships, even if they didn't name them that. But one woman that I talk about in the book, who was actually a novelist who wrote the book and then later film Young Man with a Horn, depicted lesbians in her plays and her novels. Her papers and her husband's papers are at Stanford. She never divorced. Trying to remember exactly when she married, I think like in the 1920s. She and her husband they remained married until her death, but she had a lesbian relationship, a longtime lover that her husband knew about, her mother knew about, they were together for decades and decades. Her husband had his own heterosexual relationships on the side. That kind of coexistence was something that they worked out explicitly when she told her husband about her kind of feelings. He was like, well, and her relationship with this woman, he was like, well, you just need to have, we can work out an arrangement and you can have a couple weeks off. I can't remember if it was a couple weeks off or maybe it was a full month every year, when you can just be with her and, that will be great. And that's the arrangement that they stuck to. And she called it the arrangement with a capital A. I mean, obviously things weren't always easy and she and her husband had a very volatile relationship. And she also refused the label of lesbian throughout her life. She died in the 60s. I know about that because she became friends with another novelist, Alma Routsong, who was the first woman I showed with four children. They developed a friendship when Alma was just in high school through letters. And she told Alma Routsong explicitly, Alma left her husband and came to identify as a lesbian, that wouldn't be possible for her. And it was just going to have to be the way it always had been, neither black nor white. This history, of course, definitely stretches back earlier into the 20th century and, earlier than that, for sure. Thank you so much for that question, Julie.
All right. Next question we had from Abina Oseo-Sari, who remarks how fascinating the talk was and says, as someone who does a lot of oral history work, I am curious about how you manage anonymity and names.
I found many oral history interviews and, those oral history researchers made their own choices. Many, in some cases, women use their full names. In some cases, they hide them. And just use like a first name. In my own oral history interviews that I conducted, I went by what the person that I was speaking with wanted and felt comfortable with. It's interesting because a lot of like lesbian oral historians have taken different perspectives on this. Elizabeth Kennedy and Madeline Davis, who did the study, Boots of Leather, Slippers of Gold, said they decided after, thinking about the kind of post-war McCarthyism that even women who wanted to use their full names, they made the choice not to because they felt that they had to protect them. And Esther Newton has said that she refuses to hide people's identities because she doesn't want to kind of perpetuate this closeting. For me, I just really went with what people wanted. And something that's connected to that is that I did actually write about in an article for the Oral History Review that a lot of the women that I spoke with, you know, had left their marriages, but even though they had, you know, they continued to feel a great deal of regret and shame and sadness about the ending of their marriages, about hurting their husbands and, you know, putting their children through an ordeal of a divorce. And so, you know, even those women who kind of came out in the 70s as lesbians, left their marriages, there was still a lot of desire to not make their husbands or children suffer more. And so they, you know, even in recent years chose to chose anonymity. Mm-hmm. Thanks for that question.
All right, great, thank you. Let's see, we have from another faculty member, Judith Coffin, who asked specifically about how the women came out to each other. And noting that in her own work about Simone de Beauvoir, mm-hmm. she found a lot of these similar ideas. So great to have her here today.
Thank you so much. How did they come out to each other? I mean, I think for a lot of the women, it was not that they had a sense of themselves as lesbian or even as having lesbian inclinations. Many of them really didn't have any kind of connection with, you know, that word or that label that they, you know, perceived as pretty foreign to them as wives and mothers, especially in the post-war period. But it would really be that, like, these relationships often came out of very close friendships of women who, you know, whose lives were intimately connected, who spent so much time with each other, with their children, confiding each other about their spouses, and then, you know, being physically affectionate, and then that becoming kind of sexual, being really surprised and confused by that often, but acting on it nonetheless. So often it was not that they were like, well, I am, you know, are you, you know, like, let's go. You know, it was like, often they would narrate this in their letters because it would be such a kind of pivotal moment in their lives. But you know, that first kiss or like a touch that was clearly more than a friendly touch, and how that kind of really shook their world.
All right, thank you. Our next question, we have one of our graduate students, Tiana Wilson, who would like to ask her own question. So we're gonna try to get her up here in just a moment. There she is.
Okay. Hi, Dr. Gutterman.
Hi, Tiana.
For this presentation, I really enjoyed it. My question was so I have read Dr. E. Patrick Johnson's No Tea, No Shade, and where he's kind of like talking about the difficulties of writing about Black lesbian and Black queer women. And part of his struggles was kind of like a lot of these women, as you mentioned earlier, didn't identify themselves as lesbian, partially because they can engage in like sexuality on a spectrum, but engage in these like same-sex acts is still not labeled themselves, and how men didn't have the same kind of So I guess I was wondering, what role does like patriarchy play and hypermasculinity, and how these women were kind of allowed to maintain same-sex desires within their marriage? But also you mentioned how like during the 1970s with the increase in divorce rate and how like it, like the restrictions increase, like again, that's still like because women are leaving their marriages, it's threatening patriarchy. And then I had a selfish question about your experience with the LGBT Historical Society in San Francisco. I also have to navigate their archives, but I can like send you a follow-up email later because I know we're short on time. But yes, thank you.
Awesome. Thank you so much for your questions. All right. So I tried to make some notes about what you said. How did kind of patriarchy make space for their relationships? I think that, you know, a lot of women, in some cases, their husbands, especially in the post-war period, but continuing in the 70s, if for a shorter amount of time, their husbands would give them like explicit permission. Like the woman that I mentioned, Dorothy Parker's husband, who made the arrangement with her in the 1930s. And that, you know, continued into the 1950s and 60s and 70s, and I think continues today. In a lot of cases in the 1950s and 60s, it would more often go unspoken. I think that's not only because of a kind of reticence to speak openly about homosexuality or women having extramarital relationships in this period, but also because of the kind of ideology and expectation of marriage that, you know, husbands and wives, especially, your job was to keep the marriage going, to not rock the boat, you know, to not burden your husband with, you know, too many complaints or emotional outbursts, but just to kind of maintain the calm and be there for him and your children. And so in the 50s and 60s, a lot of women actually said explicitly in their letters or after the fact, I think he knew, but we never talked about it. Like the woman, Jeannie Morton, whose husband would drop her off at the gay bars, but they never talked about it. And in her oral history interview later, she said like, I think he knew I was queer. I think he knew I was queer from the very beginning of when they got married, but we never said a word about it. And so that kind of tacit discretion and, lack of kind of emotional honesty and openness in marriages created this kind of space for same-sex relationships. But I also think that many of those husbands would be willing to turn a blind eye until a certain point, until that same-sex relationship threatened to become exclusive or in some other way was disrupting his life. So there was one woman who didn't have any children. She lived in Illinois in the 1950s and early 60s. Her lover was her maid of honor. And her husband later admitted that he found letters between her and this woman. He knew that she was having this lesbian relationship, but he thought he could change her and he chose to ignore it. But he chose to ignore it only until a certain point when she started traveling to Detroit and having her own lesbian life. And then he confronted her with divorce. And so there are many cases like that when husbands are willing to turn a blind eye to maintain a kind of discretion, until the affair becomes threatening or is disrupting his life in some way. And then, of course, in the 70s, you know, women become more likely to speak openly with their husbands about their same-sex desires and relationships. And of course, in the 1970s, there's, you know, these new sexual experiments, right, of group marriage, of open marriage. And so, you know, many women that I found, you know, found that their husbands were kind of willing to try out these semi-open or semi-public sexual relationships, but that the possibility of getting a divorce and the pressure of her having a same-sex relationship openly often became too stressful, right? And those marriages typically did not last, and they certainly did not last in that kind of open marriage phase for decades, the way some of the women's lesbian relationships persisted in the 1950s and 60s, in some cases for years and decades within marriage. Yeah, I hope that answered your question.
All right, great. We have, I think the next question that came in was this one from Erica Slaymaker, who loves the book and was curious if you could share more about shifts in the role of the state in women's lives, and in particular, how state repression changed or increased over the decades that you study.
Thank you so much, Erica. Well, in the 1950s and 60s, we might imagine that was when like these women experienced the greatest discrimination. But I do think this has to do with the previous question about patriarchy. And I think in the 50s and 60s, I was just really surprised to find that we know of a handful of contested custody and divorce cases that reached the appellate level in which women were being accused by their exes of having lesbian relationships. So there are a few of those cases, but for the most part, I really discovered that there was a kind of conspiracy isn't the right word, but a desire on the part of husbands, of judges, of lawyers to really keep any suspicion of homosexuality out of the record. So Del Martin, for example, her husband in their divorce in, I think, the late 50s, you know, he brought to the judge letters, love letters between her and their neighbor that she was in love with. And the judge said, I'm not going to count this. I'm not going to see this as anything other than a friendship. And she got custody of her daughter. But there were lots of examples like that where either husbands tried to keep it out of the record, or when they brought it up, judges didn't want it to be part of the legal record, or lawyers. There was a really funny anecdote about one woman going to her husband's lawyer and being like, I'm a lesbian, what are you gonna do about it? They like worked out their agreement quietly. So I think that in the post-war period, so long as these women were willing to remain married, the state was not gonna, go very far to punish their homosexuality. And in those cases where they did divorce and it came up, there was a lot of effort to still kind of keep it under the rug and not talk about this openly as a kind of threat it certainly wasn't very viable alternative to heterosexuality, which I think was part of the reason that the, state, often in custody battles and divorce cases was kind of willing to keep this quiet. But then of course that changes in the 1970s and 80s as, a visible lesbian feminist community emerges, as gay liberation emerges, as, there are women's lands and, women living openly together as lesbians in ways that hadn't been possible before. And so that's why I think that as lesbianism became a more viable alternative, that the state family court specifically became much harsher. And really, you see then a pretty dramatic change of judges, lawyers, husbands really pushing to make their wives same-sex relationships an explicit part of, their custody battles, an obsession on the part of judges and lawyers with, well, what does she do in bed? Maybe they just shake hands. I don't know. Like of pushing women to be explicit about sex acts and even to name sexual partners, and that really didn't didn't happen in the 50s and early 60s. So that was a pretty dramatic shift.
Mm-hmm. Oh, so interesting. You have another question, sort of a different angle on same theme, from Jonathan Brown of the History Department, who asks, how does religious conviction figure in relationships between wives?
Well, I think one thing that I found that was surprising was that a lot of women found or fell in love with and had lesbian relationships with women they met in religious communities. So, you know, in church committees, there was a really funny case about a woman who was, her husband was the minister and she was the church organist in Arizona in the 1960s. And women meeting on religious retreats. And I think, you know, this has to do with, you know, churches and, you know, retreats and things like this, offering women an opportunity to be alone with other women, often without their husbands and kids around, you know, that the religious context can facilitate a kind of sense of intimacy and intimate kind of revelations and deep personal connections. Of course, there were some examples where women, because of their religious beliefs, felt very much, you know, experienced a great deal of shame and self-hatred, or because of their family members' religious beliefs, experienced a sense of shame and self-hatred, or were punished. But I really enjoyed kind of finding out about how many women met in church choirs and, you know, through their religious communities.
Great, thank you. All right, next question from Rachel Hope Cleaves, who thanks you for your talk, especially today, and has a question about the continuity over time of anti-identitarianism, sorry about that, in married women who have relationships with women. I got the sense from your discussion of the modern examples at the beginning of the talk that this refusal of labels today is basically seen as internalized homophobia, a reluctance to come out. Or do you think this is that this continuity of identity refusal also points to the incompleteness of the supposed transition from acts to identities? I.e., we believe that we live in the age of identities, but many people's complex lived experience suggests otherwise. There we go, long one.
Thank you so much for being here, Rachel. Yeah, I didn't mean to imply that their lack of claiming an identity was about a kind of shame or internalized homophobia. I think it comes from a new flexibility that women see in terms of sexual identity labels, or a sense that specifically the term sexual fluidity, of a feeling that they don't have to pin down their identity, in that they don't feel that same pressure in a way that women coming out in the 1970s or early 80s felt, you know, a great deal of pressure from lesbian and gay activists specifically. And I think I kind of trace a little bit of this history or this shift in the epilogue, because in the 1990s and early 2000s, there was a whole slew of self-help books that came out for wives who desired women that said explicitly over and over and over, you don't have to name yourself as a lesbian, you don't have to name yourself anything, and there's no one right path. You don't have to leave your husband, you can have an open relationship, you can, you know, one woman said, if you can imagine it, it's a possibility in terms of a way of organizing your life. So there's definitely been a shift, you know, from the kind of 1970s and 80s moment in which these women were experiencing a great deal of pressure to leave their marriages, to claim a lesbian identity if they wanted to be part of a lesbian feminist community. Whereas today, you know, there seems to be, at least they, you know, feel less pressure to do that and a kind of more flexibility in terms of how they identify or how they ultimately decide to, you know, balance or not their same-sex desires and their marriages to their husbands.
Great, thank you. All right, next question is from Jillian Frank, who says, one of the things I so appreciate about your book is how it invites us to rethink marriage and its relationship to heterosexuality at mid-century. Can you tell us a little bit about how encountering these histories and sources reshaped your own understanding of marriage as an institution?
Thanks so much, Gil. Yeah, I think what I guess it was just really, you know, delving into these letters and the personal stories, women's experiences, as well as, you know, the ways that I felt like other people, husbands and judges, were trying to keep this, you know, these same-sex relationships out of public view, that it definitely changed how I thought about marriage in the post-war period, and just came to seem that there was this flexibility in the institution that was, you know, not being reflected in the historiography on marriage in the post-war period, you know, which portrays it as really rigid. And instead, it forced me to really think about the ways that, okay, in, you know, you couldn't certainly, a woman couldn't certainly legally marry another woman in this period, but, you know, in many ways, the law didn't go very far in policing marriages between men and women. And, you know, in so many ways, marriage provided access to privileges and a kind of way of, or somewhat degree of freedom to, you know, explore same-sex desires or, you know, relationships with other women. And there were a couple examples that stick out in my mind. One was the historian I mentioned, Rochella Thorpe, did oral history interviews with women who were in the lesbian, post-war lesbian community in Detroit. And there was a group interview with three women. And one of them was saying, most of them married in the early 60s, you just had to get married because then you would get that Mrs. in front of your name. And then you could basically do whatever you wanted, but then you wouldn't be gutter, or she used some phrase like this, because you'd always have that Mrs. You know, you'd always have that claim to respectability. And another anecdote is about Pat Bond, a lesbian World War II veteran who later became a performer, a very out lesbian. And she was investigated by the military because of a lesbian relationship she had in the army. And so then she just rushed and got married to a gay guy. And, you know, the investigations against her were dropped. And it was that simple because she had that, the, you know, veneer of marriage, and that was enough for the military. And, you know, that was enough, you know, for a lot of women in their kind of communities as well.
Great. Thank you. And thank you for the patience of the listeners as I try to pronounce the names and probably mess a couple of them up here as we go. But I'll try my best here. Next question is from Melissa Cherenko, who is an IHS fellow this year, who would like to know, were there differences between women leaving marriages for lesbian relationships versus heterosexual relationships? How were same-sex affairs versus heterosexual affairs viewed in this period by any number of groups, husbands, the state, mm-hmm. or any other?
Thank you. Yeah. I mean, some husbands said explicitly, there was one, at least one anecdote you know, where a woman said, her husband said to her explicitly, "I don't care what you do with women, but don't do anything with men." And, you know, so in some cases that would be spoken, and more often it would be unspoken. Do I think, you know, that these women's husbands would have been willing to turn a blind eye if, you know, their wives had been engaging in a heterosexual affair? I doubt it, right? I think that has to do, again, going back to that kind of patriarchy question, where that seems inherently more threatening, or would have seemed more threatening to a lot of husbands, where, you know, what two women did together, you know, sexually or romantically, didn't really seem substantial. It didn't seem to count. It didn't seem to matter. You know, and a lot of, you know, psychiatrists and psychologists said, you know, that these are passing feelings. They're not serious. It's not anywhere near as substantive as a heterosexual relationship. And, you know, that this is part of why certain husbands thought, okay, this will pass, or I'm not sure exactly what's going on, but I'm just going to ignore it and wait for it to end, because they had that faith that it would, that it wasn't really substantive. I'm trying to think if I had any other, and certainly, I think on the part of like judges and lawyers, that willingness to hide these same-sex affairs also was not the same way, you know, for if a woman was engaging in a heterosexual extramarital relationship, she would, you know, certainly that would come up, would be something that her husband would use against her, because that would have been a key way, especially in the 1950s and 60s, you know, that he would, could possibly be released from alimony payments. I don't think that they were seen either by husbands in intimate relationships or by the state, that same-sex relationships and heterosexual relationships were seen in the same way. Mm-hmm.
Great, thank you. And we are running out of time, but we have one final question for you from Mikey, who thanks you for this talk and says, read the response to the question of identity. I'm wondering if there can be drawn theoretical or material, perhaps weird asynchronous connections, disruptions between incremental identity of lesbian, quote, tendencies you mentioned in reference to psychoanalysis and contemporary notions of sexual and identitarian, I need to look that up, fluidity.
Yes. I definitely think that these types of identities speak to each other, but the concept of sexual fluidity, you know, is it itself historically specific and contingent. For the incremental understandings of lesbianism or homosexuality were, you know, that this is something that needs to be combated, that it is like a threat to my mental health, that it is something I can work through and overcome with a therapist, and it doesn't have to be defining of who I am or my life. And sexual fluidity, as Lisa Diamond describes it, you know, and as it has been kind of taken up in pop culture, is much more coming from a space of accepting and supporting unconventional sexual desires and identities, but is really about a resistance to a rigid, you know, hetero-homo binary or a rigid identity category. So, I think it's definitely influenced by, you know, queer theory and queer politics that are kind of anti-identitarian in a way that I think is different than what was happening in the immediate post-war period. It's also sexual fluidity as a concept is also highlighting this idea that sexual preferences and desires can change over a lifetime. And Lisa Diamond argues that this is something particular to women, which I don't really buy. But many women have found that idea really freeing, right? That that it's okay, that my desires can switch, and that over the course of my lifetime, and that if I, you know, now find myself drawn to women, that doesn't mean my previous kind of intimate relationships with men were a lie, or that I was hiding my true self. It's that I've changed and I've evolved, and I might continue to change in the future.
All right. Thanks. Thank you for all of your answers.
I want to thank everybody for coming, those who participated. It was a fascinating talk, Lauren, and also a great respite from nail biting. Yeah. Appreciate that. And want to thank Brittany for handling these questions so deftly. It's really a challenge. I just look at the Q&A screen and I get dizzy. So thank you for that, Brittany.
Thanks, Brittany.
And hope to see you all on another occasion at the Institute.
Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye, y'all.